Welcome back to Heroes of the Dorm. I'm here, Grubby, with Jester. We are commentating for you these awesome matches here in the Super 16. And we're actually right in the midst of an epic combat.
Man, oh man, like game number one, just so back and forth. But by the end of it all, some really smart play from Team Maroon. Multiple Grave Golems going their way. And at the end of it all, at the 21-minute mark, they use that strength to grab themselves the first win. And now I believe we're getting ready for game number two.
Yeah, game number two will be played on by the choice of Eagle eSports from Florida Gulf Coast University. They're choosing to play on Tomb of the Spider Queen.
Ooh, tingles. That's tingles. The newest map, man.
Spider sense is tingling. This map is one of my personal favorites. It's a very small map, and we would love to show you a little bit more about how this battleground exactly works. Tomb of the Spider Queen. It has three lanes, just like Cursed Hollow, but there's so many differences. It's small, there's a lot of ambush places, little alleys. There's four mercenary camps, but they don't have as much priority as some of the other objectives. It's all about the gems. Collect and turn in the gems, and you will convince the Spider Queen to summon web weavers for you. Web weavers will push down all three lanes simultaneously, creating more and more summoned creatures which will fight for your side. Use them to bolster the strength of your pushing heroes and buy time to get the Grave Golems, get the push in on the enemy core, and destroy it. Use the web weavers and the Spider Queen shall have you win that game. Lovely animation there.
Yeah, the web weavers are a fantastic objective to have because they're not only going to be pushing one lane, they're pushing all three simultaneously, and they don't have any travel time. They have a little bit of a teleport. You saw them kind of go woof and into the lanes. They are going to catch up to your farthest pushed creep wave, and that those plus the minions that she summons is going to be a heck of a push. So we're going to be seeing a lot of team fighting because on such a small map, those objective turns are paramount. So we don't want to have either side turn in, which is probably going to lead us to a lot of engages.
Yeah, exactly. A lot of engages as everyone tries to get their grubby little hands on these gems and turn them in and try and get enough gems to appease the Spider Queen to have her summon web weavers for your team and not the enemy. Now, which heroes will be most conducive to try and capture those gems and win this little combat here on Tomb of the Spider Queen? Eagle Esports says, this time, we want the Tyrande.
Yeah, the first pick Tyrande actually is the only time it's first pick here in this matchup. Everything else has always been the Jaina, and I was going to put my money where my mouth was and say, I'm likely to see a Jaina first pick. But today, these teams are going to say it's all about Tyrande, and Danny Boy is really looking to play her here on this smaller map.
Once again, on the support character, Danny Boy just had some nice plays there with Malfurion. This time it's on Tyrande, a very different playstyle, but accuracy is of paramount importance for both of them.
Absolutely.
How will Team Maroon answer?
Well, they have a myriad of options to them. I mean, if you do grab some early supports, we could be leading into a support the melee hero combination. We actually might even see a Kerrigan here today. Kerrigan with some really good lockdowns available, and because it's short travel time between the lanes on this map, she can really start seeing some value with the combo. So I'm personally betting we're going to see it on either side. Not entirely too sure when, but Team Maroon, they're actually going to start off with their ETC, a very solid frontliner, and again, because of...
Whoa!
All right. Let's just talk about that Diablo instead. That is a double warrior comp on a team, on a map where a team traditionally doesn't want double warriors.
Yeah, this, this is very surprising. Diablo and ETC have been the warriors that have been most chosen so far in the Super 16. But they've always been chosen one on one side and one on the other.
Yep.
Now we see a kind of monopoly there by this team.
This feels like a deny.
Yeah.
Doesn't it?
Yeah. Because in drafts.
Yeah.
Heroes can only be picked once.
Right.
So, not only do you choose something, but you deny it from the opponent.
Absolutely. That's part of the give and take, you know, the picking of the basketball teams when you're back in gym class. You know, Jim and Fred are best of friends. All right, let's put them on the same team if we can. But if the enemy team is wise to it, they're going to split them. And just like that, our minds are blown. Zietz on Sonya. This is actually the first time Sonya we're going to see today. And that's actually not really too much of a surprise since we have both of our warrior hotshots kind of taken up by that Diablo and that ETC pickup.
Now, I've got to tell you here, Jester, right. If this was a game of low stakes and I saw a Sonya, I would be thinking that he's taking the Mickey. Sonya doesn't get picked all along.
She does not. She has had a roller coaster of rides throughout some of the patches, some of the metas, the development cycles, so to speak. She is actually in a really good quality of life situation. With the recent patches, she is now a little bit more versatile. She can do a little bit more than what she was able to do before. But coming into this, again, I definitely had my ideas on who we're about to see. It did not include a Sonya.
No. I mean, Sonya, since she cannot possibly be taking the Mickey because the stakes are so high, that means that they actually have faith. They've got training with this hero. They know in this situation she may be adding more than what a silly commentator could possibly assume. So very interesting pick there, Sonya. Third one will be Uther.
All right, so we're going back a little bit to normalcy here. Yeah. That's the double support here for Eagle Esports. But also something to remember here, Grubby, Eagle Esports chose this map. And is a really early Sonya choice.
So they were like, all right, we're cool. We're just going to take Tomb of the Spider Queen and we're going to get our Sonya groove on.
Very potentially. Yeah, if this is a canned strategy that Eagle Esports had in their back pocket and said, if we lose, we need to bring this forward, and Sonya's part of that, this actually could be trouble for Team Maroon because they have double warriors, ETC with the Diablo. That's not a lot of damage output. Will they be able to protect Jaina, however, who does have a lot of damage output?
Yeah, Jaina there and the back line. One more choice will be Brightwing, who will be the healer. Another choice, rest
that
them
is
later.
Curious.
You think so?
Well, the Brightwing, we talk about the different style of heroes. Malfurion, a little bit more trickle through. You got to wait to level 10 for the big burst. But we talk about Uther and Tyrande, big burst heals. Brightwing definitely falls more towards Malfurion. It's not a lot of up front. It's a lot of over time. And this could potentially be, again, a big team killing comp from Eagle that Brightwing won't be able to stop.
Yeah. It depends if they take another support there for their fifth pick, but this will be a decision they can delay until they see the entire lineup for Eagle Esports, who has chosen to go with Zagara. Now, this is my dream pick on Tomb of the Spider Queen. Anytime I play on this map, I want to go for Zagara. What?
No, the timing there was phenomenal. But why not with Zagara? I know, that's why I did it out. But why not on Zagara? It might be your dream. Sonya might be your dream.
It is
but
a nightmare.
Nova is the number one player killer out there, my friend. And Sergeant Balance on Nova. Again, big burst damage. I don't have the confidence of Brightwing right now to deal with this.
Okay, let's take a look at Nova because I want to explain why I'm so surprised.
All right, go ahead.
Nova, she's a permanent cloaked hero, a sniper, and that's what she does. She runs around, cloaks herself, and snipes. She is not the one to do ye old tug of war with the opponents. She's very squishy, has a low defensive capability, but she can hit really hard in just the space of half a second to a second. She can unleash a lot of fury upon the opponent. Now, this hero is awesome when you play against uncoordinated teams who don't know left from right.
Absolutely.
You can pick off one guy here, and you can pick off another guy there. But this is a coordinated team battle, and they apparently feel that playing with Sonya and Nova can give them what they need.
Well, we'll have to see if that's going to be a 1-2 punch indeed. The last pickup here from Team Maroon will be Vala. Near lead once more, going to be bringing forward the double hand crossbows. And you know, the Vala and the Jaina, very steady kind of damage from the Vala, very bursty from the Jaina. It's the same kind of idea a little bit here from Sergeant Balance and Whiteout. Very bursty versus very steady. Both sides do have the damage, but it is the big difference of the double warrior composition from Maroon, which, again, I'm feeling a little off about.
Yeah, it's definitely different, which makes this one such an exceptional exception to watch. Let's get into the game. I can't wait. This is certainly an unusual beginning to this game, as we've got Nova and Sonya for the blue team. Eagle Esports playing for Florida Gulf Coast University, and they've got Zietes, Danny Boy, Illidan, Sergeant Balance, and at the very bottom, they've got Whiteout.
Absolutely. And these are the guys that need to kind of bring a win to this map of choice. On the flip side, however, not to be forgotten, Team Maroon from Texas A&M. They put a point on the board with some really good play, but Ghost Sun, Don't Kill Me, K, Noctis, near lead, and into the bottom lane will be their Valor player once more of revenge.
All right, we've got a 4-1 split. There's a top lane and a middle lane, but they're so close together, separated by just very little territory and a paying station for the gems.
Yeah, take note here, ladies and gentlemen. It is going to be very small pans between lanes because that's how close they are. It is one of our most engaging maps going back and forth because there's just so little space to spread around. And with 10 heroes here ready to battle, well, I mean, tears are going to be shed, blood will be drawn.
Yeah, this is pretty much a guarantee, as we now have a 1-3-1 split, lots of the action here. And we can see that Sergeant balanced at the bottom lane. She's just looking for an opening, the Nova player.
Ooh.
Doing a bit of sniping on Revenge, who smartly dodged it with the vault. And part of playing a cloaked hero is that the enemy is, they're scared. It's more difficult to see them. There is a slight bit of a blur. You can detect her, but from your peripheral vision, you won't see where Sergeant Balanced is.
Yeah, there is a really big advantage going the way with that cloak, but let's just see if Zets can actually get out of this troublesome situation. Over the shoulder he goes from Ghost Sun, but Noctis not able to quite break through the hit points of that tanky warrior as of yet. We're going to have to see later on how that damage scales. But yes, Nova, you will see a shimmer. She's a little blue, a little translucent. That means that she is stealth. She does not show up on the mini map at all for these players. So when they go back and forth and say, where's Nova? I don't know. She could be here, could be there. It's a big information game.
All right, Don't Kill Me, K is making an aggressive move there on Zietz, but he actually get taken down. Whoa, that was fast. And that's the power of Nova there. Sergeant Balance, beautiful Lunar Flare by Danny Boy. And Zietz, I mean, it's Sonya. It's a hero that doesn't get picked a lot, and she's been most attacked in this game. Could it perhaps be the disrespect that I kind of show towards Sonya too? But they bite back, man.
Well, sometimes you're going to see these almost like joke compositions coming forward. And every time you see a Sonya, you're like, ah, all right, easy win. But if you underestimate her, if you underestimate Zietz, he will take those swords on the back of a Nova snipe and take you to town. So we're going to have to really keep an eye on in terms of what kind of rotations we're going to see from the top to the mid, from the mid to the bottom. You've seen now Nova roaming around. You see Zietz now visiting the top, now coming back into the mid. It's still very much an experience game in the very beginning. But of course, you know, there's no big timings here. There's no spawns, there's no day-night cycles. Every gem comes from these spiders. So both teams need to spend a little bit of time farming up those gems from these spiders and making sure that they will have enough for a turn-in eventually.
Now, what I usually haven't seen on Tomb of the Spider Queen is that people are actually going to the Bruiser Cap this early. Now, I think Eagles Esports knows, but right there on the right side, Bruiser Camp is being done by the two warriors. Certainly not the highest damage dealers, and that's why it's taking them so long.
It's going to be hard to take them down, especially this early on as well. I mean, Ghost Sun has some of the highest hit point regeneration in the game, and Don't Kill Me, Kate does have a self-heal ready to go as well. So that is really early Bruisers. That is a good point. And the warriors are saying, well, we don't really have much to do right now. There's a roaming Nova. We're not going to be able to go back and forth if we get caught between the lanes. So they left the other three teammates into the lanes for experience, and now they might try to capitalize on a bit of a push or a turn-in during these Bruisers, and it looks like that's actually what happened.
All right, yeah, 25 gems are being turned in already for the red team, only 19 for Eagle Esports. They will need a good amount more. Zietis is actually sitting on 18 gems right there. This will bring them a large part of what they need, but paying it is fraught with danger. Ambushes are sure to happen.
Now, there's a few different ways that I've seen Nova actually play it out, you know, in Heroes of the Storm, in Heroes of the Storm in general. I'm going to point out her level 4 power gain is called Gathering Power. This actually empowers even more. That snipe, the pinning shot coming out. Sergeant Balance isn't going to go for quick kills. He's going to go for that damage by the end game.
Whoa.
And there's that snipe just off to the side. Sergeant Balance, with that powered up snipe from the Gathering Power, was able to take home the takedown. But at the same time, Sonya did turn in.
Yep, Sonya got to do that turn in, as indeed Revenge was taken down by that snipe, as you said. Now, it's called Gathering Power. It means Nova continues to get stronger every time she gets a takedown on the enemy heroes, up to a maximum of 5 times getting stronger. All right, Web Weavers have been summoned. And how are they going to do this? How are they going to play it?
So some teams like to collapse into one lane, try to push the power of a web weaver. You can see here, it's just going to start assaulting and assaulting until its life expires. It summons those minions. It's going to keep the Team Maroon really busy. Top lane, similar idea. So what do? Do you defend all three? Do you go lane to lane to lane? What does the attacking team do? Right now, we got the four-man Team Hero Collapse in the top from Eagle Esports. It looks like this gate is going to be the big casualty here, and that actually puts us now almost an entire level ahead for Eagle Esports.
Yep, and they'll be trying to maybe use that here to do a fight, but it's ZX who takes most of the damage here, and if you can at all avoid it and disengage from combat, if one of your heroes is under half of his health pool, it may be wise to do exactly that. He is healing now, he's getting closer and closer to our healthy health pool, and they could be looking to try and deny the enemy from turning in gems.
Now, we do need 25 more gems to be turned in here from Team Maroon. They're going to get scouted out here. They have that probe, and they see Zietz. They go right on top of him, and over the shoulder, down goes Sonya. It's going to be the takedown on top of Zietz. A little bit, perhaps, too comfortable with that. Sonya did not expect that kind of big damage coming out. But at the same time, there's the snipe. It will stop Don't Kill Me, K, from turning in those 13 gems. Now, Grubby, we've said this. You got to turn in the gems. What if you die with the gems?
You're going to lose all your gems, and it's up to your allies to have just a few seconds to try and salvage some of them. But if you can't, if it's in dangerous territory, they are lost forever. The enemy won't be able to pick up your gems, but they will be lost to you, and therefore an effective denial, Jester.
And that is why we see more and more teamfight-oriented compositions on this map, because if you can continually kill off your opponents, not only will you have naturally the advantage, but you're also denying them the big objective of this map, which are those gems. Now this time, red webweavers on the floor, and they're pushing in. So far, looks like we're going to nurture the mid-push. We are level 9 on each side. We're very close to the heroics here from Eagle Esports. Team Maroon has to know that. So how far will they push in with this?
Yeah, that's exactly the question. Right now they see level 9 on the scoreboard for the opponent, but as soon as it's level 10, expect an instant reaction of pulling back. Are they pulling back? They are.
Yeah.
Yeah, they're scared of that. They're giving it due respect.
Now they're not too far off themselves. They're not going to be able to capitalize on any kind of big team fights here with those heroics while the web weavers are up, but they are about to hit 10 themselves. And, you know, as it turns out, we will have a little bit of thinking time. What heroics will these two teams take? Because, you know, with the ETC and the Diablo, those are two big warrior combinations, but will it be Stage Dive or the Mosh Pit for ETC? Will we see Lightning Breath or the Apocalypse for Diablo?
Now, what do you think?
I think we need the damage. I would rather see Diablo actually pick up the Lightning Breath and perhaps a Mosh Pit to go with it.
Okay, so the way it works, ETC, he's an historical character from the Warcraft universe. His name in full is Elite Tauren Chieftain, and it kind of started as a band of people, a band of musicians from Blizzard. They're really running with that idea, and they came up with this Tauren called the ETC, and he's a very cool character. He's one mean cow. He's got a lot of musical power in him, and one of his heroic abilities is called the Mosh Pit. Can you explain how it works?
Well, we're going to have to see which one it will be, but the Mosh Pit by itself, it's that big dance. We've seen it time and again. If you're stuck dancing, you can't defend yourself, and that is a great opportunity for some of the teammates to try to capitalize. Will it be the Mosh? It is the Mosh Pit.
You're on
and
point.
It is the Lightning Breath. So we're going to be looking for some dancing ravers to get hit by lightning. I'm sure they'll be happy about it, but they'll lose all their hit points regardless.
All right. Watch out for watching this concert. That's one mean cow. ETC on point there with the prediction, Jester. Lightning Breath and Mosh Pit it is. Also, Ring of Frost was picked on Jaina. So no more I like to have a pet, it's bring your pet to work day for Jaina, where she brings that water elemental out. But she went for Ring of Frost.
Now, both sides are actually going to be going back and forth. They're looking for those turn-ins. They're looking to put up as much pressure, gather as many gems as they can, because a team fight is very likely imminent very quickly. But if they can actually take a team fight on the back of a web weaver push, those web weavers are not going to be really under fire from a lot of those opponents. So going back and forth, it is going to be the heroic leap coming out for Sonya, played out by Zietz. But we also have the Divine Shield, this time from Uther. And that is going to be probably the big 1-2 punch we're looking for. If Elodin there can shield out Zietz, and Zietz jumps in, there's nothing the enemy team can do about it.
Yeah, exactly. And that's how the Eagle Esports would like to see that fight start. Whiteout with the Devouring Maul, Nova with the Precision Strike. It's a globally cast spell. It's a giant strike from the skies, which will do area of effect damage on all enemy heroes caught in it. Normally, this is relatively easy to dodge, but if it's followed up after the devouring maw from Zagara, that would be the kind of combination that we're looking for. So lots of combination play there possible for Eagle Esports. Team Maroon, we've already discussed it. They have a very good combination too. So what happens when they both want to pull off their combination? Well, it's just about the execution there.
Yeah, it comes down to how well as a team you will perform. And going back and forth, I mean, sometimes some heroics will actually counter out others. It depends on the time that they go back and forth. And as I said, the shield into the heroic leap, into a devouring maw, vice versa, could be the big thing. We're going to have to find it. There's a shield. And the leap lands on top of Don't Kill Me, K. Here comes the precision strike from that maw, and down goes Near Elite. The lightning breath from Gosan is not going to hit anybody because they are already ready for it. They did do their quick retreat, and they get that one takedown.
All right. Sometimes we see a takedown for one team. Eagle Esports got it. But who actually got the better end out of it? Now, the logical explanation would be to say, the simple one at least, would be to say, okay, Eagle Esports is ahead. But they used all five heroic abilities there. And only two heroic abilities were used for Team Maroon. So they still have three of their abilities up. And this could mean that the next engagement, if it happens within the next, say, 50 seconds or so, could go definitively to Team Maroon.
So, I mean, it's one takedown. It's not the end of the world, but with those web weavers, this is a good chance to spread out, do some damage in some of these lanes. We also have mercenary camps that also retreat during this phase. So if you want to grab those early, you have to do it before the web weavers come to be. Unfortunately, nobody here with that. Instead, it's this collapse, and there goes Jaina.
Yeah, Noctis got taken down there. It was a 5v4, a nice lock there with the stunt. They're pushing in hard with the weavers. The top and the bottom weavers are still alive, but we're looking fully at this one. Now a 5v4 situation. The more time that Eagle Esports can buy, the more distraction provided from the other web weavers, which Team Maroon will pay the price for.
Yeah, bottom has been cleaned up. We saw the bid now actually cleaned up there as well. But Eagle Esports are going to push into the top, get that fort. So they do finally put a fort to their name, and that's actually the first infrastructure death, which sounds a little strange. 11 minutes in,
yeah,
and that's finally the first fort from either side. But that's just, again, a testament to how well these two teams are playing here in game number two of this best of three.
All right, so far the Sonya and Nova composition are getting this honor of having the first takedown there on an enemy fort. They have a lot of gems here. They would like to pay it. They're just being not too impetuous. They think, well, we don't want to be caught with our pants down, proverbially, and are not paying those gems immediately yet. Maybe thinking that the enemy could come with an attack from the right. Sentinel is being used by Danny Boy. You saw that little flying owl kind mm-hmm. of thing. It provides vision, and they saw the enemy team is currently doing the bruisers.
Yeah, so they know that it's going to be Team Maroon a little bit distracted, as they do need to capture out those mercenaries and enlist their aid. At the same time, we're going to take this opportunity from Eagle Esports to go grab those siege giants into the bottom. Both of those, it will actually be the bruisers into the mid. So they're kind of going to pass each other on the separate lanes, but at the same time, both teams do need to react to those mercenaries because they do not want to give away anything for free at this stage in the game.
Yeah, exactly. Nothing for free. Everything at high price.
Wow, that's actually really close. 49 gems after that turn-in from Team Maroon. If they get six more into the coffers for that Spider Queen, we will have once more red web weavers coming onto the stage. Now, you also might see 55 to 60. What's up with that? Every time you turn in, the price goes up by 5, and you got to start at 0. So this is also almost like a counter. We've had two turn-ins from Eagle Esports. This would be the second that we are looking for Team Maroon.
Yeah, exactly. The third for Eagle or the second for Maroon. It's only fair that Maroon gets it here. But you know what?
Fair.
Nothing is fair in battle. It's our turn, man. Let us play.
I'm not too sure how Sun Tzu would feel about that, so with that kind of statement. But if
very
anything,
true,
you do not want to give a fair chance to your opponents. You want to solidify that win and get yourself to that epic eight. It's going to be up to Team Maroon to earn that turn in. But there goes Zietz. He's saying, no dice, not today. There's the shield as well. He's going to be chasing off Gosan, and don't kill me, K, into that top. Here's the Devouring Maw. Who did it take down? Nobody. It didn't hit anybody, and that is a little big wasted heroic. There goes Whiteout, as you saw. Zagara is now down, but Diablo is going to pay for it with his life. We have now the Emerald Wind from the Brightwing on
Danny
top.
Boy,
on
he's top. Dancing. He's dancing. He's loving it. He's loving it, but he's getting taken down, and he will get taken down. Revenge is out of position. Elodin is on top of him, but he's getting support there from Near Lead. And don't kill me, K. He's getting away. Sprint used on Brightwing. Oh, she's so fast trying to get away.
Oh, where are they going?
In hot pursuit.
Oh, man. Like, going up to there, that's a dead end. Zietz was really looking for that takedown. In fact, Gosan is actually back. That five-second resurrection from all those souls are going to be really good here for Maroon because they have an extra body on the field. Sonya is going to go down, and there goes Illidan into his ethereal form. Unfortunately, nobody to heal, and all those gems are now out of this game.
Oh my god, they will get taken out. The hero levels here, 16 versus 15, and to the victor once again go the spoils. But is the Eagle Esports is gonna take it lying down? They certainly don't want to. They're coming in here to push. Precision strike, dodged by everyone. They continue their advance. Two heroes poking in there, trying to do damage, trying to get what advantage they can. Snipe missed. Ghost on, trying to zone people out. And it was captured. This boss will be pushing the top lane.
Yeah, and that's what I was kind of curious. So in the back of that last engage, where were people going? There is a big nasty boss up in there, and this is the equivalent of a Grave Golem on this map. He has a little bit in terms of a different ability set, but he still does the same function. He pushes down and starts wrecking your infrastructure.
Yeah, exactly. He can slam like that. He can slam with the best of them. In the meantime, the Red Weavers will be descending. They use the boss as a distraction to get those last six gems paid off, and that's what they do. This little purple blob will spawn a web weaver there.
Yeah, and there's those minions. She can have actually six minions per web weaver pushing down a lane if they do not have any kind of big aggression. So Sergeant Ballast and Danny Boy, they're going to be here for defending out the mid. But everybody from Maroon went into the bottom lane. It looks like that's where the big concerted push is going to be. You see the web weaver, you know, with those minions throwing off as much aggression as she can, and supported by a full team here from Team Maroon, who does have the level 16 power-ups. That is a very scary thing at 16 minutes.
Yeah, it is scary. What blue team needs to do is consolidate their forces, come together, and try and defeat the final web weaver at the bottom. But they know that this web weaver at the south will be used as a distraction by Team Maroon to try and take down this middle fort.
And there goes the web weavers. They are now done, and we thank them for their service. But that's another fort into the pockets now of Team Maroon. They've taken a little bit of the experience lead. I don't think they're jonesing for a fight, but Illidan's saying, yeah, I really want to. Fortunately, the rest of the team said it's not worth it. We're going to back off, reevaluate, and regroup.
Yeah, sometimes you can have the best possible initiation or first move, but if you're not ready to make the second move, then it isn't worth much. Either than tried, it's okay, but his team was just a little bit out of position. That's because Team Maroon escaped no second earlier than they should have.
Now, in terms of how many gems do we have turned in, 31 right now for Eagle Esports. It's just fresh 12. Don't Kill Me, K did that turn in 20 right there from Nearly, and it's going to go unopposed. That has now actually put us in a very good spot, because if we have another great team fight here from Team Maroon, they will be losing, or they will be denying the gems from Eagle Esports, which means they cannot complete that turn in, whereas at the same time, they're very likely to get another set of web weavers.
All right, 34 versus 31, a small lead for Team Maroon. They're not exactly paying up now. They do seem to have a sufficient amount of gems to pay here. Well, almost at least. I think they're missing two gems. So they need to get a few more gems. They can get it from the spiders, but they know nothing comes without a price. No such thing as a free lunch. So they're setting a bit of a trap here for Eagle Esports.
And there's the Starfall from Danny Boy, just forcing them off this point again. Whiteout is actually mounting up, looking to see if they can continue on with this engage. Zietz, perhaps a little bit too far for him, but there was no engage from Ghostson on top of him. So it's just going to go back to a little bit more of this tug of war. Red on Team Maroon. Really want to turn in. Eagle Esports don't want to let them. They are even on levels in terms of everything in this game. It's been very close, back and forth. Every heroic is up except the Starfall, and that is an advantage for Team Maroon.
Yeah, what Starfall does is a bunch of damage in a circular area as well as some slow effect. It is not the most impactful of heroic abilities, but missing it can still hurt Eagle Esports. So if time continues, they are perfectly okay with that. It takes 50 seconds to come back, but somehow I fear a battle may be happening before that time, Jester.
50 seconds is a long time in hero brawlers, in team brawlers like Heroes of the Storm. Even sometimes 6 seconds can be way too long. You're waiting for a cooldown. The situation can change in a blink of an eye. I like what Team Maroon is doing here. They're clearing up those minions and denying those gems once more here to the Eagles.
All right, Zietis and Gosson are in direct competition. Zietis using the leap on Gosson. He's getting Divine Shield and Devouring Maul with the Precision Strike follow-up. Instant deletion of Noctis.
Jaina going down very quickly, but that's the mosh pit right there. Illidan, Whiteout, Zietz are all going to be dancing to their death. There goes Illidan. Zietz now does not have that support, but he does have the flash of light coming out from the ethereal Uther. He is healing them up. This is actually a good re-engage spot here for Eagle Esports. They really want to try to capitalize on another takedown, but it does not look like it will come to be. So they lost out the Uther. That's okay. Illidan will be back in 35 seconds, and they get the turn-ins, up to 45 of those 60 required. If Sergeant Bounce can turn in, that will be another set of web weavers.
Yeah, Gosson is trying to stop exactly that. Sergeant Bounce goes in for the second attempt, but there is Gosson trying to interrupt him again. It's a 4-versus-4 situation. 15 are being paid by Don't Kill Me K. Another 10 coming in for Team Maroon.
10
that will
is
leave
so
us
close
with the awkward amount of one gem.
Come on, Gosan, it's up to you. But the decoy is real there from Sergeant Balance. It's going to chase him off. Any attack, even from a decoy, even from a hologram, is still going to interrupt that turn-in. And I find it curious. You know, there are two turn-in spots, but neither team has decided to go for the other.
No, we want this one. It's like wanting to play with the same toy. 20 gems. He needs to pay only one, but he got interrupted by Whiteout. A very timely interruption. Will it be able to be done again, though? No, the Banelings are blocked by Don't Kill Me K.
Too little, too late.
The payment was made.
All right, Web Weavers descending. These are not level 20, 20-minute Web Weavers. These are significantly stronger than those first ones we saw 3 or 4 minutes into the match. 10 minutes, 16 minutes. We've actually had a lot of turn-ins, as it turns out.
Yeah.
But these 20-minute Web Weavers, if they are supported, and I fully suspect we're going to see aggression now from Team Maroon, this could lead us into a keep, if not more.
All right. Yeah, that's exactly what could possibly happen. Everything will depend on the fight that's happening here. Blue cannot wait too long. They've got to go in. We're waiting for a Whiteout Devouring Maul here. She's going to try and get the enemy together. As soon as the red team clumps too much, Whiteout will try to get a Devouring Maul, or perhaps Zietis will jump in with his leap. But as you can see, a wonderful spread from Team Maroon.
Yeah. It's going to be the five-man push top. And so far, it's the five-hero defense as well from Eagle Esports. Those other lanes are also pushing in, and those Web Weavers are significantly more healthy than these top ones. So it's actually not going to be working for Eagle Esports. If they cannot take an advantage into this top, they might give up way too much in the other lanes.
Now, Team Maroon just reached level 20, but guess what? Eagle Esports as well. The closest game that we've seen as of yet in the Super 16, an amazing match. I feel so privileged to be able to watch this from the front row seat. Now they're pulling back. Team Maroon is going back. There's still Web Weavers in the bottom lane as the middle was cleaned up.
But deftly. Yeah, that's the thing. Look at that mid. There's no gate there. Bottom went all the way from the Team Maroon base all the way through bottom lane into now the other opponent base here of the Eagle Esports. That was a lot of experience and a lot of map pressure lost out by EU Esports because of that five-man defense. Now, the problem is it's another catch-22. If they hadn't defended, they would have lost a keep. But because they did, they only lost those gates to the keeps instead.
Well, they did really good not to lose any keeps, huh?
I actually really did expect to see more aggression from Team Maroon and a keep on top of it. But as it was, Eagle Esports, this is their map. This is their choice and their composition. And I got to say, it's working for them. They are up in the takedowns, 8-6. They are tied up with the levels. They're slightly behind overall. Team Maroon will hit 21 first, but can they actually take this fight?
Oh, Whiteout with the Bolt of the Storm away, Devouring Maul catching two people, but she gets taken down. Mosh pit was used. Revenge dropping so low. Sergeant Balance trying to run away.
Yeah, but Sergeant Balance did actually have the clone caught in that mosh pit, and the mosh pit was also there for Zagara on Whiteout. And Whiteout, of course, was dead by then. It was a really good reaction, but unfortunately, that's just where the aggression will end here from Team Maroon. They now have to deal with blue web weavers, and wow, they really dealt with that top wing fast.
Yeah, so fast. They were in the perfect position to stop that, but it was a real trade-off there. It was Zagara and Nova there being caught out. Zagara did pay for it with a takedown, and this allows, within a 5-versus-4 situation, to have Team Maroon clean up those web weavers way quicker than they normally would.
Now, it's kind of like another kind of puzzle going forward here. Ego Esports have more heroics ready to go. They can engage, and they've shown that they have the burst in order to take down one of the more squishy back-end targets, like a Jaina, like the Brightwing. But they're down a man. They're down that hero. Finally, Zagara now coming back into this match. It's really hard to do a 5-on-4, even when you're even on levels. But level 20, especially with so many Bolts of the Storm in this game, it's a very tough position for Ego. They have to really tiptoe around this late game if they want to punch through this aggression from Team Maroon.
Yeah, exactly. Now, Ghost Sun paying those 33 gems, a big payoff. The leap going in. Don't Kill Me K is getting away there. Emerald Wind was used by Near Lead for to disengage. Ghost Sun a little bit out of position, but he is very tanky. Zietis is getting focused here. Ring of Frost misses completely. That's a big problem. Zietis chasing there with the Divine Shield. Starting his whirlwind, the whirling blades, trying to do damage and getting away. Devouring Maul, it's gonna happen.
There's the Prison Strike coming in as well. Immediately, Bolt of the Storm there from Noctis. On the other side, Whiteout taken down. Oh. Taranda is also now dropped here as well. That was a fantastic lightning breath from Ghost Sun. Two takedowns.
Where did he come from?
He was always there. He was the big initiated target, but he is so tanky. And with that Brightwing, those heals over time, if you cannot burst down a Diablo, and it is really hard to burst down a Diablo, those heals over time from Near Elite have really paid off. You know, I was doubtful of it in the draft, but so far the double warrior composition has really held firm.
Yeah, an amazing move there, catching two people with that lightning breath all the way from the south, even as Brightwing was at the very top right of that fight, sprinting away. And now with 5-versus-3, they're able to capture that boss. Are they going to push with the boss or perhaps in a different lane? It's always so nice to distract the opponent with attacks at different places.
It comes down to how many gems they have, and look at that. 33 gems is enough. They're going to have the Grave Golem in the top. They have now red web weavers. There's not going to be any kind of bruisers unless they get their Toot Sweet, and it's not going to happen. Instead, it will be nurturing out this push. They have the level advantage. They're still two down from those takedowns on Eagle Esports. They're just now back into this map. Every heroic is ready to go pretty much here for Eagle Esports. They need to synergize it greatly here if they don't want to lose.
Yeah, there they go with the Starfall. The enemy team would rather not like to walk into that. Team Maroon is leaving and going to the middle. Spider web weavers are now arriving at the very edge of the struggle of lane minions. So we have a very advanced web weaver at the top, and it's right here at the middle. The bottom web weaver is still a little bit further away. Top one has been removed. And now what we will see is a concentrated fight here in the middle. This could be game point.
Oh man, there it is. That's going to be the Maw from Whiteout. He blinked forward, however, to do it, and Ghost Sun is going to be on him with that lightning breath. We saw the Precision Strike, and now the Ring of Frost as well. There goes Uther. Illaudin is going to be in that ethereal form, and he is really trying to heal up this Zietz in the back. Sergeant Bounce with those decoys, just trying to confuse the opponents, but the opponents are not taking that bait. Team Maroon has cleaned up this mid-keep. It is done, and they are going for the bottom with that other web weaver. This is going to set us up for a completely naked core push.
Yep, all three keeps taken down, which means all three lanes will be pushing with catapults. Now it's like a war of attrition. There's catapults pushing everyone. They will continue to do damage, and they're just going to provide so much pressure. You need to keep people to defend against these catapults, the web weavers, at almost all points in the game, which makes it so difficult to contest those objectives in the middle of the map, those gems. And even this bruiser camp, which, you know, by right belongs to the blue team, but the red team says we deserve it.
By position, perhaps. By right could be a little bit too far on that one, because so far Team Maroon has really taken a lot of bruiser camps to their name. Level 23 to 21. This is actually now starting to become a little bit more of a traditionally longer game, which is, again, really interesting because this is a very small map. We've had so many engages, but there's only 10 takedowns to 8. That's 18 total in 27 minutes. This is actually a little bit more of a rarity in Heroes of the Storm.
Yeah, it certainly is. Very good job by the support, and they're picking their fights very wisely. Now, speaking about wisdom, it's a little bit difficult for Eagle Esports to find wisdom now. They're getting pressured on every lane. Not only those catapults and traditional lane minions, but these siege giants. There was another bruiser camp captured. It's now pushing in the middle. Team Maroon can continue to collect gems very happily and pay them off. They have four forts versus zero. And at any time,
naked core.
They could swoop upon the naked core, yeah.
So far, it does look like the double bruisers have now been taken. One on left, one on right, and we are pushing in here from Team Maroon. Lots of heroics are ready to go. We likely have those souls ready for Ghost Sun. We do not have redemption on Illidan. When he did die in that last engage, he was taken out into his ethereal form, but he came back because of that level 20 Storm tier talent redemption. That has a hefty cooldown, however, and that cooldown is not going to be ready for this upcoming engage. So Illidan has to be very careful with his positioning.
Yeah, you're quite right. A 3-minute cooldown on that, and I'm pretty sure we're not in that yet. Sergeant Balanced is not doing that kind of hyena style anymore, trying to get any carrion that she can find, but she has to stay with the team. It's too dangerous now to split up for her. So we've got these five, and Eagle Esports is just hoping that the five of them can find someone isolatedly, but traps are being set here for them. Already Ghost Sun jumping in, nice Bolt of the Storm, away from Whiteout, and Zyet is not ready to jump in yet, as they are pulling all their heroes back together.
So that engage might have looked a little lackluster, but it was a big win there for Team Maroon, because Ghost Sun went in with that Shadow Charge, forced out the Bolt of the Storm on Whiteout. That, again, cooldowns are going to be coming into this. We have a small window where she won't be able to do that again. So if Ghost Sun finds Whiteout on that front line, she cannot bolt.
Yeah, for the next 15 seconds, Whiteout has to play it conservatively, and you can see her right there at the back. She's a very key hero for her team. It kind of starts with either Zietis or Whiteout with the Devouring Maul and that leap. Now, why do we see such a conservative play style from Team Maroon? What are they waiting for, you think, Jester?
It's careful play. They're waiting for as many objectives to come up into their favor as possible. You've also been seeing them trickle in some of those gems. They're up to 35 of the 70 required. There's no reason to take risks when you're ahead on this map,
but
if
this
you
is a
get
risk.
Webweavers to do it.
This is a risk. Devouring Maul and the Leap going in there, catching two heroes. Precision Strike catching two people there. The Lightning Breath happening, though. Two people down already on the side of the Eagle East.
Danny Boy is actually going to be added to that there as well. And this big boss, he is not actually captured yet. He's still fighting for everyone. He's in fact going to turn his wrath to Illidan. And there goes that Ethereal Uther once more. So many gems now denied to Eagle Esports. 1, 2, 3, and 4. It was 4 takedowns. We're now at 14-9. And this is a very powerful push coming in. Ghost Sound blinks in, finds Illidan. They did have that redemption up eventually by the end of it all. But, you know, Uther and Ghost Sound, they're not really going to do much against each other. They're just not built for that. And now we can even just safely ignore Illidan and go straight for the score.
Yeah, an amazing game here by both teams. That Sonya Nova pick really worked, but the Team Maroon managed to take the victory anyway. A wonderful performance by both. They really did their research here, as you know, they were ready for this pick, Tomb of the Spider Queen. Victory goes to... What are they called?
To Team Maroon.
Team Maroon, yeah.
And it will be the 2-0 for Team Maroon as well. I know it was a crazy game. That was actually one of our longer games here as well, over the 30-minute mark. And as Heroes of the Storm, as we said, it's a game of decisions. It's a game of gaining strength as time goes on. 30-minute matches, it was phenomenal, but I'm not entirely too sure we'll see too many more of those. But we're also not going to be seeing any more of Eagle Esports, as it is a 2-0 victory for Team Maroon.
Yeah, wonderful game there. I think it's the longest game we've had so far in Super 16.
And By far.
My, it was a knuckle cracker. We actually would like to show you one of those moments there in a replay that we have lined up for you here. Seemed to be starting a little bit with an advantage for the blue team here. They started to initiate Devouring Maul and the Leap there. Precision Strike
Boom.
Coming in.
There goes Noctis right there. That the Devouring Maw set up into the precision was it. But look at this counter. That mosh pit. Three heroes from Eagle Esports. And they just start falling down after that. You can already see the Ethereal Uther there from Illidan. He's there for the heals. But unfortunately, that's all he can kind of contribute at that point, because he's already taken down.
Yeah, that was an amazing moment there. It's all about paying off those gems, and lots of fights are bound to happen there as they're trying to do that. Cool game between these two teams. We have another team advancing to the Epic 8. We've got a lot more games coming for you today. Really awesome. Maybe we can take a look at the brackets at some point later to see what is happening with the teams here. But first,
you know, we are going to be setting up for our fourth set and match here in the Super 16 of Heroes of the Dorm. Number four today is going to be the University of Illinois at Urbana up against the University of Connecticut. Definitely some teams that know what they're doing. Perhaps we'll see some more specialized picks like the Nova, like the Sonya. But either way, when we return, we will set that up. I believe I will be joined by myself and Tim Fraser, a.k.a. the Trixler. And he'll be joining me for game number four.